Well, that is loud. Yeah, then. So, I was going to start off with a couple more double kind of things. But I feel like we've fairly thoroughly covered that topic. So, we'll do a couple examples and then we'll start talking about what's up next, which I think you guys will start talking about next week, which is sequences. So, we'll do a couple of these and then we'll move along. Here's one to start. the integral from 0 to 9 of the integral from square root of y to 3 of 1 over the square root of x cubed plus 9 dx dy. And as is the case with many of these double integrals, we're going to have to change the order of integration, which means we're going to have to draw the region of integration. So that's where I'm going to start. So again, I'm always looking at the inner limits of integration to draw the region. So I'm going to draw x equal to the square root of y and x equal to 3. X equal to root y. So be careful, right? It's not y equal to root x, which looks like the square root. It's x equal to root y or y equal to x squared, but it's just the right half. So there's x equal to the square root of y. And then x equal to 3 is a vertical line. And without any other knowledge, my best guess is it's probably going to be this region right here between those two graphs. But if I look, oh yeah, y is going to go from y equals 0, which is that x-axis, to y equals 9, which is probably where these intersect. And yes, if y is 9, the square root of 9 is 3. So these definitely intersect at the point 3 comma 9. So our region was thought of using horizontal cross sections, but now we're going to use vertical cross sections to rewrite it. So now my inner integral is going to go from a low of y equals 0 to a high of this function, but instead of thinking of it as x equal root y, we're going to square both sides to think of it as y equal to x squared. And that's going to be a dy. And then my outer limits of integration are going to be x equals 0 to x equals 3. That's going to be a dx. And my integrand hasn't changed. Still 1 over the square root of x cubed plus 9. Which I suppose I should have mentioned is not something we could easily integrate. Right? 1 over the square root of x cubed plus 9, probably impossible to actually find the antiderivative of with respect to x to start off. So usually with these double integrals, if the first thing looks hard or you know it's impossible, that's usually a really good sign that you should change the order of integration. That's almost, I mean, really like if something even looks like even just kind of hard, it's probably a good sign that we should change the order of integration because that's usually what they're trying to get you to do. So then we antidifferentiate with respect to y, which is not a big deal because we're just going to get y times the thing that doesn't have any y's in it. So we're going to get the integral from x equals 0 to x equals 3. And the antiderivative of this is going to be 1 over the square root of x cubed plus 9 times y, evaluated from y equals 0 to y equals x squared. We're going to plug in x squared for y and then subtract and plug in 0 for y. That's going to end up leaving us with the integral from 0 to 3 of just x squared over the square root of x cubed plus 9. Yes. The rest of this is not particularly terrible. A lot of the times when you get this place, it's going to be a u sub. So we're going to do the u sub. We're going to let u equal the x cubed plus 9. The du is going to be 3x squared dx. I don't have a 3, so 1/3 times du is equal to x squared dx. So my integral from 0 to 3 of x squared over the square root of x cubed plus 9 is going to become the integral. We'll worry about the limits of integration in a second here. The x squared times dx is going to be equal to 1/3 du, and the square root of x cubed plus 9 is going to be the square root of u. And it's not too terrible to change the limits of integration here, so let's just do that. If x equals 0, u is going to equal 0 cubed plus 9, which is 9. And if x equals 3, u is going to equal 3 cubed plus 9, which is 27 plus 9, which is 36. Clearly, someone thought about this problem ahead of time because I can see that those are both square numbers. When I try to plug them in later on, it's going to work out okay. But even if they weren't, it would still be fine. So then we're going to rewrite this as the integral, I should say 1/3 times the integral
from 9 to 36th of, instead of 1 over the square root of u, we're going to say we have u to the negative 1 half. Then we're going to find the antiderivative. We're going to get 1/3 times u to the positive 1 half. Dividing by 1 half is the same as multiplying by 2 from 9 to 36. Since we changed our limits of integration, we do not change back to the variable x. We just leave it as u. We plug in u equal to 36 and u equal to 9. So we get 2/3 times 36 to the 1 half minus 9 to the 1 half. And although you could leave it like this, we really should simplify it because these are simplifiable. So this is going to end up being 2/3 times the square root of 36 minus the square root of 9, which is just 2/3 times 3, which is 2. Like a lot of work for just 2, but sometimes the answers turn out really nice. So any questions about any of what we did there before we do one more example in this kind of section, and then we'll move on to the next section. Go ahead.
Well, not on this one, but
Okay.
can you go through what the move problem
Yeah, definitely, of course. Yeah. Sure. Let's see. I might be able to pull it up here. Is it from, let's see, I'm guessing it's homework number 7 or homework number 6. Since problem 1.
Yeah, I the one
Sure.
giving was 6 1, 16, 6, and plus 1. And
So let's
then
see. Ooh, I have a, let's see. So I'm seeing something that says something like maximize f of x, y equal to x times y subject to the constraint 3x plus y equals 18. Is that similar to what you have?
yeah.
Okay. So this looks, wow, they really are having us do like all the steps here. So let's take a look at this. And we can use my numbers or what were your numbers?
Well, one constraint was 6x plus y equals 16, and I ended
And,
up
okay.
not being able to get y.
All right, so let's see here. So we're gonna maximize, and it's still the same function we're maximizing.
Yes.
So maximize f of x, y equal to x times y. The constraint was, remember, 6x plus y equal to 16. So you said?
Yeah.
Cool. So first rewrite the constraint as g of x, y equal to 0 by subtract. Wow, they really just like, I mean, feels like, so they tell you what to do by subtracting 16 from both sides. So our constraint is going to be g of x, y equal to 6x plus y minus 16. Cool. And then we're going to compute all derivatives f of x, y minus L times g of x, y. In class, we use lambda, but since you can't enter lambda in web work, we will use L here instead. Okay, that's fine. Seems sure there's a way we can make lambda work. All right. So our f of, I'm still going to write lambda here. I think you guys can make the transition from lambda to L. So f of x, y, lambda is equal to little f of x, comma y. Minus lambda times g of x comma y, which is going to be x times y minus lambda times 6x plus y minus 16. Seems straightforward enough. And then we're being asked to find all the parts. So they're really, I mean, this problem really is walking you through all the steps, right? You set it up and then you find all the partials. So my del f del x, or as I would prefer to write, my fx is going to be y minus lambda times 6. My del f del y, or my fy, is going to be x minus lambda times 1. And finally, although I don't care to write it because I've already written it, our del f del lambda, or f lambda, is just the derivative of this respect to lambda, which is just going to be negative 1 times 6x plus y minus 16. And technically, to have it be correct, it doesn't have the negative in front of it to get the right partial derivative there. So we're going to set them all equal to 0. And let's read the instructions here. So we set all the partial derivatives equal to zero. Take del f del x, which you entered above, set it equal to zero, and solve for lambda. So we're going to solve for lambda. Great. So I'm going to get y equal to 6 lambda, which means y divided by 6 is equal to lambda. Similarly, in the... Let me read the instructions here. Plug this expression into lambda for del... Wow, this is not the way I would do it. I really don't like the way they're doing this. Fine, I'll follow the instructions. So then they tell us to plug this expression for lambda into your del f del y. Personally, if it were me, I would first solve for x. And I would really, I would really not do it this way. But okay, I would solve for lambda in terms of x and then set them equal to each other. Fine. So we're going to plug this in for lambda here. And we're going to get x minus y over 6 equal to 0. And then solving for x, we would get x equal to y over 6. I guess that's not that different than what I like to do. I would prefer to first solve each of them for lambda and then set them equal to each other. But that would still result in the same thing. We would have lambda equal to y over 6 and lambda equal to x. And then we would set x equal to y over 6. And we'd still get exactly that. Okay. Then we're going to plug this expression for x into del f to lambda set equal to 0. So this is working us with the same process. They're just doing it in a slightly different way than I've described it in class when we're doing Lagrange multipliers. But essentially, we are getting either x in terms of y or y in terms of x, or more generally, all of the variables in terms of one of the variables. So if it's x, y, and z, which is a more typical situation, we're getting y and z in terms of x, or x and z in terms of y, or x and y in terms of z, whatever makes the most sense. So here we're going to take this thing for x and we're going to plug this in for x right there. So we're going to have that negative 1 times 6 times y over 6 plus y minus 16 equal to 0. And then we're asked to solve for y. I'd multiply both sides by negative 1. So then I have 6 times y over 6 is y plus y minus 16 equals 0, which is going to lead us to getting 2y equal to 16 or y equal to 8. I don't believe so. So what I'm doing here from this step to this step is I multiply both sides by negative. I don't have to do that.
If you multiply that by negative 1, you get negative 2y minus
16. But this negative 1 is just getting essentially multiplied away. Right? I'm really just left with that, everything inside the parentheses, which is positive 6 times y over 6 plus y minus 16 equal to 0. Or I could distribute the minus sign. If I did that, I would have minus y plus 16 equal to 0, which is still going to result in y equal to positive 8. So then plug this expression for y back into your equation for x you got above to find x. So then we would get x equal to 8 over 6, which is 4/3. And then finally, you have now found the x and y, which maximize the product subject to the constraint. What is the maximum value of x times y? Well, we would just literally say, x times y is equal to 4/3 times 8, which is going to be 32/3. So not too terrible, but again, maybe a... just slight variations in the way I usually like to approach the steps, but a totally fine way of doing it. Really, with Lagrange multipliers, as long as you can get there, it doesn't really matter what way you get there. Just some people think of it different ways depending on how you do it. And to be honest, right, Professor Berg didn't write this question. Right, she might not really think of it exactly this way, although she probably is not too far from this because the person who did write this question is someone we also talk to frequently. So. They're probably not far from each other on how they think about this. Ow. Sorry. That's not too terrible. I guess I should ask, are there any other homework questions? Are there any other questions about the homework that are troubling or
causing strife.
I'll take okay, that's fair. Yeah. Sure. Yeah. Well, generally it's fine to ask. Sometimes I'll change them up, but like, yeah. Let's look at one more double integral thing, and then we will talk about sequences for a minute, just to get you kind of primed for class next week. Because that I'm pretty sure that's what you're going to start with on Monday. Let's see where you're up. Let's do this one. Yeah. So let's find the average value of f of xy equal to e to the y squared over the region bounded by y equals 1/2 x, y equals 6, and x equals 0. Something I want to point out here is that, so actually a couple things. So first and foremost, the average value is just going to be the double integral over the region of our function. I would normally just write dA here, but here's actually what I want to point out. We know that if we're trying to integrate e to the y squared, we cannot anti-differentiate with respect to y first. The antiderivative of e to the y squared is something that doesn't exist. So we know for sure we're going to have to do this integral as dx dy because e to the y squared doesn't work otherwise. Can't do the y part first. And then on the bottom, we're just going to have the area of the region, which we might do as a double integral, or it might just be a nice square or rectangle or triangle that we're easily able to find the area of the region. So both of these things, either way, require us to draw the region. Drawing the region is like 70% of the battle when you're doing double integrals. Yeah, the integration part can still be challenging, but really drawing the region is kind of the bigger deal. Let's see, I've got three curves. I've got y equal to 1/2 x, which is just a nice straight line through the origin. I don't really care exactly how I draw it as long as it's somewhat decently good. And then y equals 6 is a horizontal line. I'm just going to label my lines y equals 6, y equals 1/2 x. And then the thing that throws people all the time is x equals 0, right? That's the y-axis. Make sure we got that right. Also, I would point out here that if you accidentally thought it was the horizontal axis, there wouldn't actually be a region that was bounded by those three curves, right? There is nothing that gets enclosed by y equals 6 and y equals 0 and y equals 1. So you kind of just have this infinite area that wouldn't be very helpful. So we are looking at this triangular region over here. And since it's a triangle, we might as well just find its area real quick before we do anything else. So let's find some points of intersection. Up here, where y equals 1/2 x intersects y equals 6, we would just be setting 6 equal to 1/2 x and getting x equal to 12. So that point right there is the point 12 comma 6. And this point right here is the point 0 comma 6. So let's say the triangle has a base of 6 and a height of 12, or a height of 12, 6 and a base, whichever way you want to think about the height and the base here. One of them is 12 and one of them is 6. So the area of the triangle is just going to be 1/2 times the base times the height, which is going to be 36. And that's going to be the denominator of this average value calculation here. So this is going to be whatever your double integral is divided by 36. Cool. So we just have to find the double integral. So like I was saying, we have to do x first. So we have to do x equals something to x equals something as our inner integral, meaning we have to use a horizontal cross-section. So for our inner integral, We're going to go from as far left as x equals 0 to as far right as the slopey line there, but we need to solve for x as a function of y. So instead of saying y equals 1/2 x, we're going to rewrite that as 2y equal to x, or x equal to 2y. That's going to be my dx. And then my outer limits of integration are just going to be how low and how high that strip can slide. It can slide as low as y equals 0, as high as y equals 6. That's how we're setting up the double integral there. Questions about that? Okay. Let's find out questions. And then we do the integral. A lot of the time with these double integrals, the function is going to be a function of the other variable. It's like when we integrate this with respect to x, we just get x times the thing that's already in there. Because as far as x is concerned, e to the y squared is a constant. The integral of a constant is just the constant times the variable that we're integrating with respect to. We're evaluating that from 0 to 2y. And then outside of that, we still have the integral from 0 to 6 dy. The inside thing here becomes really nice. It's going to be, we're going to have the integral from 0 to 6. We're going to have e to the y squared times 2y minus e to the y squared times 0, which is just 0, which we're not going to write. And this, I think, you couldn't have a more obvious u substitution. Your u is y squared, your du is 2y. The integral of e to the y squared 2y is just going to be e to the y squared. I feel like we've seen this enough that you could probably do it without even writing the u sub. Because what's the derivative of e to the y squared? It's e to the stuff times the derivative of the stuff. And the derivative of e to the y squared is e to the y squared times 2y. Oh, exactly that. But you can also do the u sub, right? It's totally fine to do the u sub here. I just kind of skipped it. But the u sub would have been u equals y squared, du is 2y dy. And then you'd be integrating e to the u, which will be e to the u. So then we plug in our limits of integration. I didn't change them because I changed back to y without writing anything down. So plugging in my 6 and my 0, I get e to the 6 squared minus e to the 0 squared, which is just e to the 36 minus 1. So then my average value is going to be that integral divided by 36. I should do that volume divided by 36. Not too terrible. All right. So, not that we can't ever come back to double integrals or other things, but I'm going to move on and talk about sequences for the last 20-ish minutes here. Let me start. One thing. So sequences. What is a sequence? Well, a sequence is really just a list of numbers that have, well, don't have to, but often have some sort of pattern. Really, a sequence is just a function. So for example, here's a sequence. A sub n is equal to 2n over n plus 1. Excuse me. It's kind of like saying, it's kind of like f of x equal to 2x over x plus 1. The difference being that when we're talking about a sequence, n is only allowed to be integer values, typically positive integer values. So usually you're starting at either like n equals 0 or n equals 1, and then just finding all of the subsequent terms of the sequence. So for example, the first term of my sequence, a sub 1, I'm going to get by just plugging in 1 for n. I'm going to get 2 times 1 over 1 plus 1, which is 1. And my a sub 2 is going to be 2 times 2 over 2 plus 1, which is 4/3. And we can go on this way. My a sub 3 is going to be 2 times 3 over 3 plus 1, which is 6/4, which is 3/2. Eventually, it gets kind of annoying to write what you're plugging in every time. You might notice that every time I do this, well, except I'm simplifying, it's kind of annoying, James. It'd be easier to see if I wrote this one as 2 over 2, and this one as 6 over 4. Every time I do this, the top is increasing by 2, and the bottom is increasing by 1. So I can see that a sub 4 is going to be 8 over 5, a sub 5 is going to be 10 over 6, and it just goes on and on and on and on and on. In fact, if you go way, way out, like to say a sub 100, that's going to be 200 over 101. And a sub 101 is going to be 202 over 102. And if you look at that, those numbers there are pretty close to 2. If you pull out the calculator, 200 divided by 101 is like 1.999 or something. A question we often like to ask about sequences and later on series is, does the sequence converge or diverge? So does a sub n equal to 2n over n plus 1 converge? Meaning, if you let n get larger and larger and larger and larger and larger, does the expression a sub n equal to 2n over n plus 1 get closer to some specific number? And the answer is yes, in this particular example. And the way we find that is by just taking the limit as n goes to infinity. So we take the limit as n goes to infinity of 2n over n plus 1. And there's a couple ways we can deal with this. You could either use the idea that we have a rational function where the degree on top and the degree on the bottom are the same, and the limit's going to be the quotient of the leading coefficients. But if that doesn't ring a bell or it's been a little while, the more general method of attacking something like this is to divide everything by n to the highest power that's in the denominator. So we divide everything by n, 2n divided by n, n divided by n, 1 divided by n. The limit as n goes to infinity, well, 2n divided by n is 2, n divided by n is 1, 1 divided by n is 1 divided by n, but then 1 divided by n gets smaller and smaller and smaller, closer and closer to 0 as n gets larger and larger. So this limit really is 2 over 1 plus 0, which is 2. So we would say that this sequence converges to 2, meaning it gets closer and closer to 2. It might not ever actually get to 2. Some sequences do actually hit their value and then kind of go back and forth across it. This one doesn't ever actually equal 2. It's going to be just slightly smaller than 2, and it's going to get closer and closer and closer forever and ever. So that's kind of the general idea with sequences, is we ask, does the sequence converge or diverge? If it converges, what real finite number does it converge to? But sometimes they don't converge. Like, for example, something like a sub n equal to 2n cubed over n squared plus 1. Often we are asked to find the first few terms. Let's go ahead and find the first 5 terms. Typically, it is my responsibility or whoever's writing the question's responsibility to specify where we start. If it's not specified, the assumption is usually starting at n equals 0 or n equals 1. I would usually assume n equals 1 unless told otherwise. So we're going to start with n being bigger than or equal to 1. So a sub 1 is going to be 2 times 1 cubed over 1 squared plus 1, which is just 2 over 2, just 1. A sub 2 is 2 times 2 cubed over 2 squared plus 1, which is 16 over 5. This might get kind of big. Sometimes they get big. A sub 3 is going to be 2 times 3 cubed, 3 squared plus 1, which is, 3 cubed is 27. 27 times 2 is 54 over 9 plus 1 is 10. Interesting point. There's usually not a lot of benefit to simplifying these expressions. In fact, later on, when we start talking about trying to find the pattern based on the first so many terms, it's usually disadvantageous to simplify the expressions. So I'm not going to simplify that. A sub 4 is going to be 2 times 4 cubed over 4 squared plus 1. And 4 cubed is 64 times 2 is 128. I guess I should say I'm technically simplifying it right now, but okay, fine. or 17. And then finally, the fifth term, a to the 5 is going to be 2 times 5 cubed, or 5 squared plus 1. 5 cubed is 125, so we get 250 over 26. And it looks like these terms are just getting bigger and bigger. 16 over 5 is a little bigger than 3. 54 over 10 is a little bigger than 5. 128 over 17 is, I don't know, bigger than 8 maybe. 250 over 26 is almost 10 if it was 260 over 26. So it looks like things are getting bigger. So we might have something that's diverging to infinity. It's getting larger and larger and larger without bound. So converge or diverge? Well, whenever we're asked this question, we're really just being asked to take the limit as n goes to infinity. So find the limit as n goes to infinity of your expression a sub n. In this case, that's going to be the limit as n goes to infinity of 2n cubed over n squared plus 1. And just from a gut instinct kind of place, it looks like the numerator is going to grow faster than the denominator. Right? If we plug in n equal to 1,000, 1,000 cubed is much larger than 1,000 squared. In fact, it's like 1,000 times larger. So it looks like the top is going to be a whole n's worth times bigger than the bottom. But if we do this, we can apply the same sort of method we did for the last one. We're going to divide everything by n to the highest power. And this is where it's really important, the highest power that is in the denominator. It's not undoable if you divide everything by n cubed, but it's easier if we divide everything by n squared. So if we divide everything by n squared, we get the limit as n goes to infinity of 2n cubed over n squared over n squared over n squared plus 1 over n squared, which becomes the limit as n goes to infinity. 2n cubed over n squared is 2n. N squared over n squared is 1. And 1 over n squared is 1 over n squared. But look what happens now. This 1 over n squared is going to go towards 0 as n gets really, really big. And the numerator is going to go towards infinity, actually twice infinity, but still infinity. So you get 2 times infinity over 1 plus 0. And 2 times infinity is still infinity, and dividing by 1 is still infinity. So what we would say is that this sequence diverges. So a sub n equal to 2n cubed over n squared plus 1 diverges. We usually only care about saying if something diverges. We don't really typically care in what way it diverges. But if you wanted to be more specific, you could say it diverges to infinity. And there's kind of three different ways something can diverge. It can either diverge to infinity, it can diverge to negative infinity, or it can do something where the limit really doesn't exist, like some sort of oscillatory behavior. For example, here are two sequences that are the same sequence written in a different way. You could have a sub n equal to negative 1 to the n, or a more annoying way of writing this, a sub n equal to cosine of pi times n. Right, that's the same, yeah. These sequences are actually the same. Now, I'll point out that these functions are not the same. If you graph negative 1 to the x versus cosine of pi times x, cosine of pi times x would look like your usual kind of cosine function, the sinusoidal usual curvy shape. Whereas negative 1 to the x would look weird. Like it would just have 1s and negative 1s all over the place and nothing else. In fact, why am I saying these look different? Why don't I just show you? Because I think it's kind of neat looking. I do think it's neat looking. Good. So the general kind of where did I put these papers here? When you have something like this, that's a rational function, meaning powers of n over powers of n, or like this, the go-to method is to divide everything by n to the highest power that is in the denominator. So that's why I chose n squared here, because it was the highest power of n that was in the denominator. If I had chosen the highest power overall in this case, dividing everything by n cubed becomes problematic because then it's not clear what sort of infinity we have. So check out this funky looking thing. Sorry, I actually have to show you so you can see it. So here's y equals negative 1 to the x. Lots of values where it's just equal to 1 and negative 1, because basically Negative 1 to any even power is 1. Negative 1 to any odd power is negative 1. But then there's a whole bunch of like weird fractional things that happen that are just kind of super strange. Whereas if you graph y equal to cosine of pi times x, well, yeah, it's hitting 1 and negative 1. And exactly, well, when x is 0, it's 1. When x is 1, it's negative 1. When x is 2, it's positive 1. Negative 1, positive 1. So as far as the sequences are concerned, these two sequences are the same because, right, if we start writing down values here, if n is 1, negative 1 to the 1 is negative 1, and cosine of pi times 1 is also negative 1. And if n is 2, negative 1 squared is positive 1, and cosine of 2 pi is also positive 1. And it just keeps going that way. If n is 3, negative 1. If n is 4, positive 1, and so on and so on and so on forever and ever. And it's kind of disappointing, but this sequence, although it's not unbounded, right, it doesn't get infinitely large or negatively infinitely large, but a sub n is in fact divergent because the limit as n goes to infinity of either one of these sequences doesn't exist. We never get close to any one particular numerical value. We just keep bouncing back and forth between negative one, positive one forever and ever and ever. So that's the third way a sequence can be divergent. You can either diverge to infinity, diverge to negative infinity, or you can do some sort of oscillating thing where you never get close to one particular number. So I'll say one. Yeah, sure. Oh, that's interesting, yeah. Let's look at a couple more examples because there are other things that happen specifically, something like, and we don't always have to use a sub n, you can call it b sub n or c sub n or kind of any other one. So if our sequence b sub n were to be equal to n to the third over 3 to the n, I always forget all this, really. Did either of you learn about L'Hopital's rule in 16a or 16b? Yeah?
I don't remember.
Okay. Yes. Well, we'll talk about it a little bit here. It's not super important. Here's what I point out about this one. N to the third is a polynomial. 3 to the n is an exponential function. And exponential functions eventually always are going to outpace polynomial functions. Or in other words, the bottom thing here is going to get much bigger than the numerator of the thing. Exponential things, 3 to the x, 4 to the x, e to the x, or n, whatever letter you're using, are always going to outgrow or outpace polynomial things like n squared or n cubed or n to the fourth, or n to the hundredth even. So if we write out some terms, it's not really clear what's happening in the beginning. B sub 1 is 1 over 3. B sub 2 is 2 cubed over 3 squared, which is 8 over 9. Fun fact, 8 and 9 are the only powers that differ by 1. Like 2 to the third and 3 squared are the only exponential things that differ by exactly 1. It's kind of neat. Not important though. B sub 3 is 3 to the third over 3 to the third, which is exactly 1. So far what's happened is we started at 1/3, we got bigger, we got a little bit bigger. And then after that, if we plug in 4, we're going to have 4 to the third over 3 to the fourth, which actually got smaller because 4 to the third is 64 and 3 to the fourth is 81. And that number is definitely less than 1. If we go further, B5 is equal to 5 to the third over 3 to the fifth. 5 to the third is 125. And 3 to the fifth is 3 times 81, which is 243. Now, yeah, we're getting a lot less. That's like pretty close to a half. This one's fairly close to like 3/4. So it looks like we're on the decline here. But how would we actually show it? Well, if I wanted to find whether or not this converges or diverges, we could take the limit as n goes to infinity of n cubed over 3 to the n. Now you can think about plugging in something like, if you plugged in 1,000 cubed is 1,000,000,000. 3 to the 1,000th power is unfathomably large. Like 3 times 3 times 3 times 3 times 3 1,000 times. I mean, 3 times 3 times 3 times 3 just 5 times is 243. Imagine doing that times itself 20 times. It's really, really big. But that's not really conclusive. It's just good evidence. So the way we actually find this limit, if we have L'Hopital's rule available to us, which again, I don't remember if we actually do. If you have an infinity over infinity type of limit, right? If you actually plugged in infinity here, you'd get a really big number on the top and a really big number on the bottom. L'Hopital's rule says you can find this limit by taking the derivative of the top piece and the derivative of the bottom piece and then taking the limit of that. So using L'Hopital's rule, which we usually write with an L apostrophe H, this would be equal to the limit as n goes to infinity of the derivative of the top, which is 3n squared. And the derivative of 3 to the n is 3 to the n times the natural log of 3. I know it's been a little while, but I'll remind you all that the derivative of e to the x is just e to the x. But then if you have a different base, the derivative of 2 to the x is 2 to the x times the natural log of 2. Or more generally, the derivative of a to the x is a to the x times the natural log of whatever your base a is. And that's where that natural log of 3 is coming from. Unfortunately, here, we still have an infinity over infinity type. The numerator is still getting infinitely large. The denominator is still getting infinitely large. So we would do L'Hopital's rule again. And hopefully you can see where this is going to go. The derivative of 3n squared is 6n. The derivative of 3 to the n times a constant is going to be 3 to the n times natural log of 3 times that other natural log of 3. We still have an infinity over infinity type, but if we do it one more time, we'll finally get a constant on top. And so using L'Hopital's rule one more time, we get the limit as n goes to infinity. The derivative of 6n is 6. The derivative of the bottom is going to be 3 to the n times natural log of 3 three times. But then we can see that we have a constant on top and a denominator that is getting larger and larger and larger, and a constant, no matter how big it is, divided by infinity, eventually gets super duper small. So this limit is going to be 0. So this sequence does converge, and it converges to 0. Which isn't terribly surprising if we remind ourselves that we thought in the beginning that the denominator was much bigger than the numerator in the first place. So if your denominator is the bigger thing, your fraction is going to get eventually small, close to 0. If your numerator is the bigger thing, your fraction is eventually going to get big and probably go to either infinity or negative infinity. All right, I think I've said enough. It's 1:55. Enjoy your weekend. We will talk more about sequences on Monday. And check out the Holo Festival. If you like checking it out. It's worth, I've definitely been to a few Holo Festivals. It's worth checking out. It's always a good place to look for a Mother's Day gift if that's something you're in the market for.